today on the Auto Channel.
With the ability to sprint from 0 to 60 in just 4.2 seconds, take a quarter mile in 12.8 seconds, reach a top speed of 180 miles an hour, and still achieve 26 miles per gallon EPA highway, the new ZR1 Corvette supercar leads a dazzling array of incredible sports cars for 1990.
We'll show you how and why four-wheel drive works, so you can use it to its fullest potential.
Hi, I'm Parker Johnstone. School's in session, and you're invited.
Plus, the Auto Channel's Buyer's Guide to RVs, restoration and repair tips, the first 100 years of the automobile, news and event information from around the world, and of course, dozens of the best deals on wheels from our local car dealers, all on the Auto Channel.
This year, Americans will spend over $400 billion on automotive-related goods and services. That's a greater consumer expenditure than any other category, including household food purchases. In order to make informed decisions regarding all those purchases, it would be good to have some help. That's what the Auto Channel is about. I'm Dennis Newhall, and in today's show, TAC will be exploring many of the automotive-related options available to you and some of the ways you can save money when you're buying, selling, or fixing any type of automobile. To start things off, let's go to the TAC studio in Los Angeles, where Bill Maloney has this week's auto news.
Thanks, Dennis. It seems that Daihatsu, makers of nice, small subcompacts, had planned to come out with a new all-purpose vehicle for 1990 called the Rocky. Well, MGM, the folks who produced the Sylvester Stallone Rocky movies, took exception to this. They're now making Rocky V, which will come out next summer. They said, "We own the name Rocky." However, all's been worked out, all's well. Daihatsu CR Dick Brown, of former DeLorean fame, worked out an agreement on the use of the name of MGM. Agreement, that's spelled M-O-N-E-Y. Ford has purchased 15% of Jaguar, much to the chagrin of the Jag board of directors. And as you may know, Ford owns a good chunk of Aston Martin, shown here winning the Le Mans 24-hour race in 1959. Hyundai, which for a couple of years could do no wrong with their sales of the $6,000 Excel, seem to think sales for this priced car have saturated the market, as their sales are off a whopping 31%. Ouch. I'll be back a little later with TAC design and technology news. Now back to Dennis.
If you're in the market for a new vehicle, 1990 may be your year. Variety seems to be as rich as it was in the 1950s, and if the 50s were the golden age of the American automobile, then the new decade may well be the beginning of the platinum age. From the opulence of the large luxury sedans to the pulse-quickening roar of the powerful new roadsters to the fun of the convertible and the four-wheel drive vehicles, there's everything you've ever wanted except tail fins. Let's turn to auto racer, writer, and engineer Rick Titus for an amorous look at this week's Countdown to Love.
One of the fastest developing market divisions for the 1990s is that of sport luxury, with new product from Japan, Germany, and the United States bowing nearly every week. And in that mix is some of the most sophisticated automotive hardware available. Making a selection amongst this group will not be easy. A little later on the show, TAC would like to share with you some tips on how you might be able to make a test drive that'll make that selection process a whole lot more fun. Until then, let's take a look at this week's profiled vehicles in my Countdown to Love.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Lexus is the new upscale luxury division from Toyota. Like Honda with Acura and Nissan with Infiniti, Lexus is designed to compete in the now highly competitive sport luxury market. All three manufacturers have been upfront and outspoken about the introduction of their new divisions, expressing confidence and a determination to succeed, but none nearly as aggressively as Lexus. At the root of all this confidence is the LS400, the Lexus flagship. Based on a four-door front-engine rear-drive platform, the LS400 has all the appropriate ingredients for market success. An all-aluminum 4.5-liter V8 that produces 250 horsepower, a sophisticated suspension package that includes an optional traction control system, which is designed to eliminate wheel spin in even the worst of road conditions. Standard features run the usual high-end gamut and includes automatic climate control, power seats with memory, a 7-speaker sound system, and power windows and door locks. Even anti-lock brakes are standard. The Lexus LS400 is base priced at $36,000. EPA mileage figures were not yet available. Pontiac's proud pony car is due for a minor facelift, interior and power improvements for 1990. The front-engine rear-drive coupe continues in a base, formula, Trans Am, and GTA model trims, all of which will receive a driver's side impact restraint airbag. The biggest news is under the hood, where port fuel injection is replacing the older throttle body injection on some versions of the 5.0-liter V8. This will add as much as 10 horsepower to the engine, bringing it to a maximum of 225, depending on which transmission the car is ordered with. And at the same time, the 5.7-liter V8 has been increased to 235 horsepower, making it one of the strongest domestic V8s on the market. The base Firebird will get a new 140 horsepower 3.1-liter V6, replacing the 2.8-liter V6 that was in the car last year. Though Pontiac has nearly 10 years on the current Firebird design, they have no immediate plans to redesign the car. With annual sales in the 65,000 unit range, the Firebird fits into a very comfortable niche for Pontiac, while still serving as the company's performance flagship. Firebird's base price is $12,238. EPA mileage estimates are 19 City, 27 Highway. First introduced at the Frankfurt Motor Show in 1963, the 911 has gone on to have a long and distinguished history. As Porsche's performance flagship, the 911 has a great number of incarnations, largely surrounding the engine and suspension. The latest being the Carrera 2, which is a two-wheel drive offshoot of last year's freshly introduced Carrera 4, and is based off the same 3.6-liter 247 horsepower horizontally opposed six-cylinder engine. New for the Carrera 2 is an automatic transmission called the Tiptronic Dual Function Gearbox. This can be driven as either a full automatic or as a semi-manual. Like the five other Porsche 911 models, the Carrera 2 is available as either a coupe, targa, or cabriolet. As it has over the years, Porsche continues to refine and upgrade the 911. As a result, the Carrera 2 will come standard with anti-lock brakes, driver and passenger impact restraint bags, force-sensitive power steering, and a new air conditioning system that features automatic climate control. Of course, all this performance and refinement doesn't come cheap, as the Carrera 2 is base priced at $52,000. EPA mileage estimates are 18 City, 24 Highway.
Well, have you found that special car yet? You know, the one that makes the heartbeat just a little bit quicker? If not, stick around. We've got plenty more to show you a little later on in the show.
Thanks, Dennis. I'd like to answer this letter that I got from Ann Berardini at Zephyr Point, Nevada. Now, Ann asked about buying an RV at a big show. Well, Ann, let me give you a conditional yes. Now, the conditional part is that you've got to do your homework first. Now, you should know at least three things: the price, the type, and the size range of the RV that you want. Now, if you know those things, then a show can be a great place to get a good deal. Now, if you go into it undecided, look out, it can be pretty overwhelming. And your first best step is what you're doing right now, watching the Auto Channel, where we let you shop from your sofa. Here, take a look.
We're getting revved up for some auctions, so put your pencils in gear. First, there's the 17th annual Dallas in the Fall on November 18th and 19th. This collector car show and auction presented by Cruise International is expected to feature over 500 collector cars.
When buying a used vehicle, most people feel that they're at complete mercy of the seller. Since the buyer doesn't know how to properly evaluate the car that they're looking at, they often wind up relying on certain less features. Unfortunately, just because the seller has a kind face or three beautiful grandchildren, that doesn't mean that you should always take the vehicle's condition for granted.
Pushing the envelope. It's what the great old test pilots called taking a chance. And whether you're pushing 180 miles per hour or pushing a paintbrush, if you want to get ahead, you've got to pull into the passing lane. In our continuing series of regular people involved in racing, this next story is about a fine artist who's finding a new way to express himself.